Yes, so I'm Thibaud, pronouns are he, him. I'm on Django's accessibility team, and I'm a co-contributor for the Wagtail project. Just want to thank my employer, Torchbox, for allowing me to be here, for supporting me. Want to thank my Wagtail colleagues for supporting this work over the years. And I want to thank my partner and my mother-in-law for allowing me to be here by looking after the kids while I'm with all of you. It wouldn't happen without them, that's for sure. The slides for the presentation are online, wagtail.org/DC2023. Highly recommend you look at the slides on your own devices as we go through this if you want to. And the slides are online. Make use of them. I'd also love to take questions towards the end. Quick quote from our sponsor, Torchbox, my employer. We're hiring, we work with lots of cool people. If you're looking for a job, give us a shot. And Wagtail, yeah, I guess I want to say, like, we have a booth, we have stickers, we have a newsletter. It's an open source project like any other. We just, you know, try our best to make it compelling. So any feedback, very welcome. And we have stickers, right? And so, yeah, why I'm here? I'm here because accessibility is a really cool thing to work in my opinion. And there really is lots more we could do in the Django universe. And I'd really like to see more people essentially take part in this. So this talk today is more of a, I'd say, a governance thing of what are the accessibility things we could do better in the Django space, rather than here are specific issues that we can find on projects together. If that makes sense. And why I'm here, plainly speaking, it's also thanks to Musharraf. Musharraf reported an issue on the Wagtail issue tracker 5 years ago now, where he said, hey, I want to use Wagtail, quite like the docs, quite like the project. Oh, by the way, I'm blind, and I discovered that my experience working with Wagtail would be rather unpleasant, the way he puts it. And it was a wake-up call for me, definitely, that the software we build, the way we build it, affects people in their day-to-day job. And I guess just when we get that kind of message from a specific person, to me, it is eye-opening that we need to be better at this. So thank you, Musharraf, as well, most definitely. And why I'm here, another reason is this big number, which I love to talk about, 96.3%. Some of you might be able to guess what it might be from my previous presentations. 96.3%, that's the amount of the top 1 million homepages in the world that have basic accessibility issues. It actually is quite a sad number, despite it being such a big figure. And I guess in some ways, like, I have a really hard time grasping a number like this, making sense of why so many of our sites have those basic issues. And I guess nonetheless, we have to try and find ways to, have to try and find ways to resolve those issues, which is why we're here, essentially. So to me, it's a bit of a North Star. I think Don used the term yesterday as well. It's this kind of very long-term goal you look towards of how can we make more sites accessible in our industry overall, not necessarily just Django. And that number is definitely going down over the years. Just like, can barely tell. It's not because of the projectors, it's just, yeah. At the current pace, it would take about 100 years for us to reach half of the sites out there having no issues. So, you know, just room for improvement. Yeah. So the good news is in the Django world, we're at 95% of the sites having issues, not 96.3. Yay. Not the exact same data set. That's from a sample of 25,000 Django sites, not 1 million, and the source is me. So, you know, take it however you want. I guess from those figures, I took it to heart to dive as deep as I could from the big number to the small number to the actual issues, if that makes sense. So yes, numbers. Developers love numbers. We all do, I believe. We're looking at a report from a tool called Lighthouse Lighthouse, I'm sure some of you might have heard of it in the field of performance, perhaps as far as SEO for Google websites. Lighthouse has accessibility checks. That's one of the figures that it does by default. And we're looking here at a report on the Django admin that gives us a lovely 88. Not quite sure whether 88 is good or not, but I guess we can work with those figures that assess a specific page of a specific site we might work on and see what there is to be done. So we'll go from there. We can actually do that with Lighthouse, not just for a single page, but for all of the websites out there in the world. That's something that the HTTP Archive project does every month of every year. And they do this also by categorizing which technologies the sites are built with. So here we have a lovely chart that is really hard to make sense of. It's the median scores on accessibility of the sites built with those technologies. So at a very high level, we can see that it's kind of quite bunched up. That kind of makes sense in some ways. But definitely there are technologies that are consistently higher up on this chart than other ones, or rather sites built with those technologies. So yeah, let's zoom in a bit and look at the more precise details. The end of the line, so to speak, in 23.3 here and now. At the very top of the list here, we have Squarespace, an online site builder, proprietary. Then we have the WordPress CMS right below, so still scoring quite great. And we have Wagtail and Rails that score 83. Finally, this all line, that's the average websites out there, all technologies included at 82. And then below this average websites, we have Django and Django CMS. So that does mean there's quite a clear call for us to improve this. And I guess at least do as good as average. We do better as far as how many sites have no issues at all. But in terms of average Lighthouse scores, at least, there is room for us to do even better. I want to say, by the way, all of those charts and bits of data sets, I have added a link at the bottom of the slides if you want to follow up on the numbers and the queries I use to extract this data. Just to hammer the point home here, comparing frameworks specifically, Django websites, the median score is 80. The all websites, all technologies, median is 82. And then there are a few tools like Remix that score much higher than that. So it might not necessarily mean that, you know, there is not necessarily a causation here, but there's definitely some amount of correlation between technology and accessibility. A quick warning, though, about those figures. They're only based on automated checks, which only find, depending on who you ask, either 57% of issues or 20% of issues. So even those figures that aren't partially good, they only tell a partial story of how accessible the web actually is, which is important to be aware of. So yeah, let's dive even deeper. Another chart that's quite hard to read, but the main point I want to make here is that the data is there for us to make sense of and see which improvements we can make to Django and Django websites. So here we're looking at specific checks within Lighthouse, checks done by the AXE accessibility testing engine that my colleague Scott mentioned in his earlier talk. AXE gives us very precise indications of what is there to improve on the sites. And those bars here, they represent how many Django websites out there have those issues. So turns out one of the most common issues on Django projects is color contrast, which you might think at first glance, oh, like that doesn't have that much to do with Django, right? But at the same time, I suppose it's definitely a choice on the part of Django for it not to have too many concerns about the front end. And I suppose nonetheless something where if it is an issue on real world websites, we do have to see how we can acknowledge it and perhaps do better. And yeah, there's plenty more down the line that are much closer to how Django works under the hood. I really like charts. Surprise, surprise. I made one that specifically compares which checks does Django do better at than the average site and which checks it does worse at. The main thing I want you to get here, the worst ones are on red at the top, better ones are in green, is that there clearly is a pattern between the technology and the results of those checks, which means there is an obvious call for us to improve on those specific results. And just to hammer this point home, I also pulled the charts from other projects I've assessed. I work on Wagtail, the CMS, so I have pulled the chart together for Wagtail, and same story. There's clearly things that we do better at as a project, and things where really, like, don't know what's up with area required parents, but there is room for improvement on that one specifically. And Drupal, same story with Drupal. Drupal websites, site implementers have opinions about how the web is built. We see the results of those opinions in what works and what doesn't. My favorite tidbit on here is my colleague Scott earlier mentioned how much heading order matters on the page. That is something where Wagtail scores terribly and Drupal scores excellently. So definitely room for us to learn from other projects there. And yeah, just one last time, I can also compare sites that my employer builds compared to the average on the web. And there's clearly some insights there that there's this one specific thing we could do better at. So yeah, technology has an impact, not just the specifics of the implementation, but the overall architecture, the way you build the project, the way you define what a project is, the process is important, the QA obviously is essential, and yeah, it all matters. And there is room for us to think about all those things, in my opinion, as a Django community, not just the backend code, so to speak. Yeah, let's dive even deeper with a demo. And we are gonna look at accessibility issues on Django websites together, which is gonna hurt a bit, but it's for the better. We all have a lot to learn from this, I'm sure. I guess just for saying, like, I have quite a bit of time, so just for saying, like, I'm not, like, trying to call out any one person, like, definitely the sentiment is here. Those issues, once we found them, they're really simple to address. So it's mainly a matter of finding them together and being aware of those issues so we don't make them in the future, and so we address them in the site that already exists. Again, DjangoProject.com, you might have seen the talk from Paolo earlier this week who mentioned that they're working on a rebuild of the site, and they definitely are taking the things that I'm gonna point out today into account. While we look at this page, can I ask from the room, like, can you spot any issues, perhaps? Any takers? Yeah, over there? Oh, thank you, Nate. It's one of my favorite things to do, is not like how many issues, but rather how quickly, when you arrive on the page, can you spot one, can you spot five, can you spot 10? It's the best indication of how good the site is.
Yes, oh, you can hear me, excellent. Okay, so first guess, bottom row, please take a few minutes to complete the. It is white on green, but I'm having a hard time reading it from here without squinting a little bit. So I would say those letters are too narrow.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, that's excellent. The readability of the text is a problem because of, I suppose, how thick or thin the font is, as well as the color. This is called a color contrast issue. That's the most common way you put it. And there's plenty of them, turns out. We mentioned this specific block at the very bottom, but this page is, so to speak, covered with those issues. I'll switch back to my full browser window, and we can use our lovely little extensions that allows us to run many checks on the page. And it's gonna point out specific elements in red. That's the ones where it found issues. This extension is called Accessibility Insights. I cannot recommend it enough because it contains both automated checks that are the best in industry, in my opinion, from Axe, as well as manual checks. So though this thing about color contrast, you can find it automatically, you could also decide to say, turn off the color on the page and find issues that way. It might make it much more obvious which things aren't readable enough if you turn off the colors. I'll scroll down a bit more, and can anyone else find another issue, perhaps? Yeah?
Link formatting, it needs an underline under
yes.
The...
Yes, yes. Not sure who here has checked their GitHub today, you might have had a notification that underlines have been turned on by default. This is amazing. Links do need underlines so you can tell where the links are. Not sure if you can like realize on here where the links are exactly. It is really hard to tell if you're on a poor monitor or just if you have low vision, like as I do. And yeah, just adding an underline, that's all there is to be done here. Really simple. And yeah, it just makes sense. We'll try and spot another issue perhaps. Can you tell me, I'll zoom out a bit. Can you tell me on this page, which of those elements is the main heading, the heading level one of this page? Any guesses? No takers? Well, let's see what our checker thinks, right? Because we do have checks for that. It might just be a manual check, but maybe it can like point out to us which element is which heading. All right, so, yeah, I mean, why not, I suppose? Yeah, so I guess, I don't even know how to say it, to be honest. Yeah, headings level one, unless you're really clever about it, it probably should only be one, not three. And I suppose like the earlier on in the page, the better. I think if I had guessed, I would have probably guessed this main element here at the top would be the heading level one. Definitely not that to the side. Definitely not like way further down like this. Anyway, just, you know, once you know about those issues and the tools to find them, they're really easy to spot. And again, like this is completely free and you have the automated checks and the manual ones. We look for one more issue about keyboard support. I'll go straight towards demonstrating this issue because it's really visual and I really like it. We'll turn on my extension's tab stops feature, which allows us to visualize how someone tabbing through the page with a keyboard would go through the elements one by one. So generally you want top to bottom and left to right in English. So far so good, makes quite a bit of sense. And it counts for us how many tab stops it takes to reach a particular item. Obviously if the item is important on the page, the sooner the better. And what I realized with this is that if I want to reach something that's visually quite far up, like the download button, it's kind of one of the main call to actions of this page, isn't it? It takes 25 tab stops to get there. So yeah, I guess definitely if this is one of the main call to actions, it probably does make sense for it to be reachable sooner. And again, like nothing specific to Django here, but being aware of those issues as a community will help us make more accessible websites. So DjangoProject.com, many issues, lots of room for improvements, but we are working on it and getting there. We can look at Django's forms templates. Django loves to tell, or at least Django people love to tell me as a front-end developer that Django doesn't have opinions about HTML and front-end and so on. But for forms, I suppose it does. And yeah. Not necessarily the best it could be. So Django's forms rendering, until quite a few versions ago, the default one was to render forms as a table. tables should be used for tabular data, not for forms layouts. I guess, you know, it does look visually slightly easier to scan than if it wasn't a table, but it creates lots of issues for screen reader users that will have to navigate this rather simple sequence of fields as if it was tabular data. The screen readers do optimize navigation experience depending on what the content is, and navigation for forms probably shouldn't be mixed up with navigation for tabular data. But I guess the good news on this one specifically is that the issues we can look at together have all been addressed already on the Django project. So I mentioned earlier that I'm part of the accessibility team. One of the first things we focused on as a team was improving the accessibility of Django's public HTML outputs rather than things like the Django admin, which we will get to, don't you worry. Specifically here, we're looking at a radio choice field with radio buttons. And the issue earlier on was that, that we can see here as well, was that when you have a group of related radios like this, they need to be in a field set so we can understand that they're grouped together, which is missing here. And they also are missing a label, which in the case of a field set group would be a legend element. And talking about legends, the person who fixed this, David Smith, is my personal Django hero. He's pretty much fixed all of the most gnarly bugs I could throw at him on performance accessibility in Django. So yeah, thank you, David. Yeah, there are other issues on here that we've worked on, but I think I might just move over to Django's admin. We need to talk about the Django admin. Like, I have a really hard time grasping how, if I look at Django's survey results, it's one of developers' favorite features in the framework, but it looks like something that's from 10 years ago. And maybe there's like a visual like choice there, but for accessibility as well, unfortunately, it is just not working very well. So I guess we'll move over to a specific demo page, and perhaps we can figure out how long it takes us to find one issue, or maybe 10 issues. Oh my gosh. I don't know where to start. There's just too many of them at some point. It's just like, okay, well. So we take it gradually. We definitely made quite a few improvements. This is Django 5.0, by the way, the latest and greatest, not even released yet. Made plenty of improvements, but there's lots of room, I suppose, to lots of space for further work to be done. Some of these are really simple to fix. I'd say like perhaps what's more interesting to discuss rather than the fixes is the fact that there might be a bit of a lack of ownership in the Django space on who works on the admin, who has the skills, perhaps making Django more compelling as a contribution project for UI, UX, front-end development people might help fix this. But yeah, at the moment, I guess there's just lots of things that are wrong with this. I think one way to put it would be that if you gave this to a colleague and they just politely said nothing, it'll probably be the best you could expect. But you could also give this to a colleague and receive a lawsuit in return, because it does prevent their people from doing their job if they can't access the admin tools for your website. So yeah, just something worth pondering about a bit. Thankfully, the Django project isn't liable for quality of the Django admin. All right, I'll try and be a bit more cheerful. Let's go back to the slides, because this can get to you after a while. Yeah, we found lots of issues. Definitely found them pretty fast, but it's all right. We're working on them. We'll talk about that next. Tab stops are great. Just a great way to, Musharraf. I guess this is what it comes down to for me. Like, I want to make it work for those people who need it first and foremost. All right, back to the slides. What to do and where to go from there? Here are all the things we could do. And I really like this slide in particular because this is a like-for-like copy of the one I posted at DjangoCon Europe 2020, 3 years ago. And one of the reasons I was very keen to be here is to report back on the progress we've made since then. The accessibility team was formed right around the time that I put this slide together. And now we actually have quite a bit of progress in all of those areas. Again, like, we have about 10 years of accessibility technical debt to catch up on. So though progress has been made, there is room for even more. I'm going to go through this list just as I switch over to the next year's, what my hopes are. Next year, I'm hoping that we'll have made even more progress on making the Django admin compliant with accessibility standards, as well as DjangoProject.com. DjangoProject.com, in some ways, is a really simple sites, in some other ways, I guess, does need all of us to agree on what the site is and how it works. But one thing we definitely agreed on is the fact that it does need to be accessible, which is perfect for me. Django features, accessible by default. We're honestly almost there. There are only a few things here and there I could report on, but overall we've made a lot of progress on this specifically, which to me feels like the right area to have focused on. Docs about accessibility as well. I'm hoping we'll get there really soon. We have pull requests open to have docs for contributors, as well as to upgrade documentation for site implementers using Django. And yeah, reviews of packages, I really feel like there's a place for this in the accessibility team, like providing guidelines or doing the reviews ourselves. A specific bit of accessibility know-how I want to leave you with as well is this shift left methodology. So it's this idea that rather than doing a big accessibility audit towards the point where your project is shipped, you do this iteratively over time. That's really what I think the Django community should strive towards of is when you decide how to build things, you take accessibility into account at the beginning in the design phase. And so for Django, what this could look like, shift left, is clearer standards for people who contribute to the project, creating new features with accessibility in mind, automated QA, we worked on that quite a bit, manual QA, having just clear guidelines on how you're meant to test your UI changes, and again, the audits still present, but only as the last result. There's also a very relevant standard that I want you to be aware of called ATAG 2.0. Again, my colleague Scott earlier talked about Wagtail websites and the fact that there was two aspects to Wagtail accessibility, the admin and the site you build with it. It's the same with Django. We have to worry about how accessible the admin is and how it allows us to produce accessible websites, which is what this standard is about. And yeah, ultimately, people like Musharraf, having them involved in this equation and having them being the driving forces behind our initiatives, to me, is what matters. And I was really elated when I saw Musharraf's reaction to my last talk on the topic. And yeah, I think it's very important to give those people the space to give us direct feedback. And thank you all, you're lovely. As an example of this, one of the most recent things I've worked on in Django is switching the date picker to be more accessible. And we've been able to find someone in our community who uses voice control software. It's really hard to find those people. There aren't many of them. So just having access to those people and them having the goodwill to work with us is really invaluable. So yeah, just finishing, there'll be plenty of time for questions. I didn't want you to use it. Finishing on what we're already up to, DjangoCon, again, just, you know, we have to value those things, accessibility of the physical space. The fact that there's multiple events around the world makes it much easier for people to attend, obviously. Guidelines for speakers, captioners. We couldn't have captioners without real humans, to be completely honest. It's just not the same, so we have to appreciate this. DjangoProject.com. Accessibility testing, I've done quite a bit of that, and it's definitely taken into account in the upcoming project. Thank you, Paolo. And the Django docs, plenty happening there as well, which are all things you could be involved with, either as an events organizer, as a DjangoProject.com contributor, or as a Django contributor. And yeah, I wanted to end with all the things I could see happening in our space to make, I suppose, to make improvements big and small. So, Dawn earlier this week and Rachel mentioned Django.space, and it feels to me like the perfect program for us to take on bigger challenges like accessibility and make much larger improvements, concerted improvements. And Django takes part in Summer of Code as well from Google. It could take part in many of those programs with accessibility being one of the focus areas. Could also be parts of sprints, could be something where we commission an audit. Could be, say, an awareness thing around having a Django Girls or official Django tutorial extension focused on those aspects. There's loads of room for improvement. We've talked lots lately about changing the default starter template in Django. And I guess accessibility improvements in the starter template could definitely help steer our community towards better practices. Oh, yeah, and a plug for the web sustainability guidelines. We're talking lots about WCAG and ATAG, but there are also guidelines from the sustainability side of the equation that are concerned both about accessibility as in usability of the web, but also things like social equity, privacy, and so on. It's all part of one bigger story. And yeah, so things big and small. The last slide was the big ones, and then the small ones. There's lots of small ways to help us improve this. We have a channel on the Discord that's really active. People share resources on there. We have an accessibility team that's present both online and at the sprints. And yeah, plenty of ways, I suppose, to make Django more compelling for UI people, whether it's by changing Django tooling, perhaps adding linting for CSS, perhaps linting templates, Perhaps it's by having sprints with designers around from your colleagues, from your companies, lots of ways for us to work with those people. And on that note, yeah, thank you all. I hope you liked it. And QA, very welcome. I'll be at the sprints working on this as well.
All right, thank you, Thibaud, for that excellent talk. I have two things, both from Sarah Abdurrahmana. First of all, she posted a heart hands emoji in the Slack. I wanted to pass it on to you.
Oh.
And second, a question from her. When, with your Lighthouse audit, that your data set was from April 1st, when did you run those tests?
Can you repeat that? Sorry, yeah.
When did you run the Lighthouse, when did you run the Lighthouse audit test that you did on from the data set from April?
Oh, okay. I ran it, so the April, I run this every couple months or so. So the April one is based on the HTTP archive data sets. Underlying data is there every month up to date, but my personal testing takes costs quite a bit of money, so I only run it now and then. It's all public, so I can definitely share both the spreadsheets where the data exports are, as well as the queries that pull the data from all the Django sites out there. For the Django admin itself, right now I only do this on a very ad hoc basis, like the full audits of the admin, but I have actually started using a platform that allows us to run this essentially on demand. So you might have seen me earlier demo the Django admin. It's actually a completely static export of the admin that anyone can go to and use for the specific purpose of testing accessibility issues in Django. So yeah, this we can run on a daily basis if we wanted to.
Great, great question. Other questions?
Sorry, there's lots of echo, so I have trouble hearing you from here, but.
So you listed out quite a few things that need to be solved in terms of accessibility in the Django space. How do you prioritize what to do? You mentioned that this part seemed the most important. I'm wondering why that's the most important, and what do you see as the next most important?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I guess to me, I mentioned the idea of the North Star earlier, this one big number that's accessibility issues in websites out there. So to me, it's like trying to think, okay, of all the things we could do, which ones will have the biggest impact on the industry as a whole? So perhaps it's speaking at events and raising awareness. Perhaps it's also, in the case of Django, fixing things that are there for websites with Django, which are much more numerous and I guess see much more traction, much more usage from people than the Django admin. So the Django admin takes a backseat just because I assume it has fewer users than the sites built with Django. And similarly, the Django docs, making sure that accessibility is quite clear, like what to do in the docs, is also because I assume people using the docs will produce much more accessible websites than if we only worked on the admin itself. Does that make sense? Oh, come on, we have so much time. I ended like 15 minutes early, just so we have plenty of time.
Thank you very much, Thibaud. You said something really interesting. Said, well, maybe this isn't the interesting problem. The interesting problem is how we're exposing these issues to potential Django contributors. And maybe we could do that differently. You suggested it might be an issue of ownership.
Yeah.
Would you say a little bit more about that, about how easy you think it might be to change that?
Oh, that's a tough question, Daniele.
Well, there was an easy one somewhere else.
Great point. I'm not on the stage for, yes. I guess to me, it comes down to quite a few things. I think in the past, accessibility might have had a bad rep as like across all the things you could do as a developer. It's just like, oh, that's kind of one of the easy ones, so maybe let's not do that. So I guess it has definitely helped quite a bit to make it, leave space for it in our communities and make it sound like it's something that's really important because it is. And I suppose in the Django space specifically, I do get the feeling that though there are lots of full stack people, they tend to lean quite heavily towards the back end, Django being a Python project, that's pretty understandable. And that does mean that we need to try even harder to find people who are keen to work on UI things, like accessibility. There's plenty of accessibility things to do on the back end, but definitely in the case of Django, there's lots of catch up to do on the front end. So I guess finding those initiatives where we can engage with perhaps a slightly different audience of contributors, perhaps with newcomers who come from the field without the background of Django expertise and might already have lots of skills on the front end where we need it the most. I guess the last thing I could add is I mentioned making Django more compelling for this audience. So things like Django templates, they are really simple on purpose. Like, I guess it can be quite a turnoff for people quite proficient with things like React, that Django on purpose makes Django templates so simple. So perhaps things to consider there is things like introducing newer tooling, or perhaps things that make Django more compelling towards front-end use cases without it being opinionated too much about which specific frameworks. And finally, the outreach programs, in my opinion, are a great way to get fresh talent who will have time to pick up the specific things, like pick up the expertise for the specific things that the project needs.
Merci beaucoup, Thibaud. My question is with regard to testing and sort of automating in acceptance testing in CI, for example, and tooling around that. I don't know if you have any thoughts you'd like to share with us.
Yeah, definitely. So I mentioned quite a bit the Axe checker from Deque. And I mentioned it quite a bit because it is open source and it is specifically tailored towards scenarios where you don't want false positives, where you want any and every one of the checks that it raises to be a real issue. So my one recommendation for CI would be to find an integration of Axe with the specific test frameworks you might have available in your specific tech stack. So tools like Playwright definitely have an Axe integration. Puppeteer as well has one. Now we're looking at the Selenium one on screen. The Selenium integration is the one that Django is hoping to use for its own test suite in the near future. So yeah, find which integration of Axe is available and run it on your website. The one thing that's tricky about this, to be completely honest, is having the test suite for your site runs in CI. So if you do already, you've solved that. If you don't, you have to figure out which test data to have running your websites in CI, which can be tricky at times.
Next questions? Yep.
So thanks for your talk. You are sharing a percentage of the admin. It's very low from the point of view of accessibility. So my question is, do you think it's possible to increase this percentage of accessibility, or it's better to maybe think to write from scratch? For example, something like HTMX or similar.
That's a great question. So the way I think about this is lots of us involved with Django, we do this on quite an ad hoc basis, just like now and then over time, small tidbits of work. It probably will be close to impossible for us to do a rewrite from scratch in that way. It just means it's gonna block any and all improvements to the current version in the meantime. So I think I would love to see a rewrite from scratch, but if we went for that, it would definitely have to come from someone who is quite well placed in the Django community and can schedule that as a program of work over multiple years. So I believe that the Django Software Foundation currently is very close to running board elections. It would have to be someone who perhaps goes to the board with this specific idea of, I think we should do this, and let's organize this over multiple years. If I had to give advice on how to do this, it would be, let's have Django participate in a Google Summer of Code and Outreachy and all those other programs with this kind of plan in mind. And let's make sure that well ahead of this, we have plenty enough mentors to support this so that as a bigger group, we coordinate on making that happen. So yeah, it's possible, but it requires lots of coordination, momentum, and I guess in the meantime, we can still work on making short-term improvements here and there.
We have time for one more question.
Thanks, great talk. Another question about tools. There are certain tools out there that promise miracles, like fix your accessibility issues with one line of JavaScript. Can you talk about stuff under that umbrella? I think it might be a bit of a rant, but we're ready.
Yes. Oh, AI. Yes. How do I do a fair take on this? I guess the best way I can put it, first of all, it might not be the most eloquent for this specific thing. So overlay fact sheets, that's the best thing to Google if you're keen on being aware of those tools and what they promise and what they might or might not deliver. This is a manifesto of sorts, and I'm one of the signatories, just a heads up. There's this class of tools, essentially, that promise quite big improvements without having to change your website's code, without having to change your team's practices. And I suppose in some ways, they do fix some issues, but the wider problem is that they might not necessarily, and you have no control over exactly what they fix. So those tools exist in the AI space. It's really common for people to promise that AI can detect issues and fix them automatically. I believe there's like definitely reason to explore this and try those out. But at the moment, I definitely would recommend focusing on the fundamentals of accessibility requirements, talking to your users, and building things from the get-go with accessibility in mind.
Let's thank Thibaud.